Hello, my name is Father Charlie Goraieb, and I serve as pastor of St. Timothy Catholic Church in Mesa, Arizona. I'm standing before you today in front of an image of the 12th station at the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, the site where Jesus Christ, our Lord, was crucified. What a perfect image that would help us today, that would help us to visualize our topic, which is Lent. I'll be with you for the next 5 weeks as we reflect on the meaning of Lent and some ideas and how to get the most out of this holy season in our liturgical year. I want to begin with a basic overview of the origin and purpose of the practice of Lent. In a nutshell, this liturgical season is a time of prayer, penance, sacrifice, and good works in preparation for the celebration of Easter. It begins on Ash Wednesday with the rubbing of ashes on the believer's forehead. This ancient practice signifies both our desire to repent of sin and an acknowledgement of our mortality. Our revered spiritual writers frequently quote the Latin phrase memento mori, which translates to remember your death. To our modern ear, that can sound morbid, but it is a realistic call to keep in mind our ultimate destination, eternal life in heaven. So reception of ashes depicts our resolve to turn from sin so that when our lives do end, we will find ourselves in the presence of our merciful Lord. The word Lent itself is derived from the Anglo-Saxon words lengthen, meaning spring. And over the years, it became a simple shorthand expression for the time of year in which we celebrate and prepare for Easter. Going back to the earliest days of the church, there's evidence of some kind of Lenten preparation for Easter. While the practices were widespread, for the first few hundred years, they were not uniform throughout the church, especially the church in the East and the church in the West. But what was universally accepted throughout the whole church was a 40-day period of Lenten preparation. When the Emperor Constantine made Christianity the religion of his empire in the year 313 AD, Lent became more regularized. From the writings of different fathers of the early church, like St. Athanasius, St. Cyril of Jerusalem, St. Cyril of Alexandria, and even Pope Leo the Great, they present a consistent emphasis on the importance of fasting and prayer and special works of charity for 40 days in preparation for Easter. Why 40 days? From the Bible, we know that the number 40 has always had significant spiritual meaning regarding particularly preparation. In the book of Exodus, we're told that Moses, in preparing to receive the Ten Commandments, stayed on Mount Sinai with the Lord for 40 days and 40 nights without eating any food or drinking any water. Then there's the story of Elijah, who walked 40 days and 40 nights to Mount Horeb, which is another name for Sinai. And of course, the most important example we have from Scripture is Jesus himself, who fasted and prayed for 40 days and 40 nights in the desert before he began his public ministry. With Jesus' 40-day experience as the model, Lent soon became established as a six-week season that begins on Ash Wednesday and continues until Holy Week. By the way, Lent does not include Sundays. We don't fast and we don't abstain on Sundays because that's the Lord's Day. The rules of fasting have varied over the years and among different countries. And over time and to this day, fasting means having one meal, usually in the evening, and perhaps some other light snacks in between. On Ash Wednesday and on Good Friday, the church requires us all to fast and to abstain from meat. On the other Fridays of Lent, we are asked simply to abstain from eating meat. These are the minimum requirements, and we're certainly free to add to them. But that's just the minimum that the church asks of us. People are also encouraged to give up something throughout the whole of Lent as a sacrifice. This has given rise to numerous well-intentioned initiatives such as not having coffee or alcohol or sweets or some other enjoyable indulgence or activity. This can be a good way to offer a gift to the Lord in gratitude for His mercy in our lives. It does require some self-mastery, which is a virtue that most of us could stand to improve on, at least a little. It also entails a little bit of suffering, which can help us grasp, perhaps a little better, the power and the meaning of our Lord's cross. Now, I've heard some well-intentioned commentators say that instead of giving up something we like, we should give up sinful activity instead. Now, I do agree that Lent is the perfect time to review our lives and see how we might overcome bad habits that have formed, like gossiping or a quick temper or watching too much TV or a host of other venial sins that have become all too commonplace. But overcoming sin is really our constant year-round duty, not just during Lent. To replace sin with virtue is different from a gift we might want to offer the Lord in gratitude for redeeming us through His suffering on the cross. What is important for us to keep in mind as we begin Lent is that penance and fasting are just one component of the spiritual life. In Matthew chapter 6, the Lord tells us that prayer and almsgiving complete the list. We're going to talk more about all of these in subsequent reflections. But what is important to stress today is that these pillars, these three pillars of spirituality, must be seen simply as tools to help us grow closer to the Lord and to become more open and generous in our love for others. Our Lenten schedule should therefore include more time for personal prayer, daily Mass, the Stations of the Cross, and adoration of the Blessed Sacrament. It is also very good to do some additional spiritual reading, especially the Bible. And speaking of reading the Bible, I strongly recommend that you dive into the Gospel of St. Luke, which is the Gospel given to us for this year C. If you've never done a through reading of the entire Gospel, you're going to discover how powerful that can be. Be sure to pay special attention to chapters 22, 23, and 24, which are the account of the Lord's Passion, Death, and Resurrection. Over the next 4 weeks, we will reflect in more detail on the big ideas of Lent. But today, now, as we begin Lent 2013, the key is for you to make a Lenten plan, one that you can reasonably keep, and allow the Lord's grace to fill you with deeper love for Him during this holy season. We'll see you next week, and may God bless you and draw you closer to Himself.
More shows can be seen on Faith and Life Television at faithandlifetv.com.